Thank you so much, sir. Very good evening to all the seniors here. Sorry for butting in like this. And thank you for allowing me to speak out of my turn. I would be speaking on algorithmic approach to managing post-refractive surgery dry eyes. Yes, we all know that refractive surgery is one of the most commonly performed surgeries for reducing the glasses and dependence on glasses. But we also know that dry eye is one of the primary reasons of patient dissatisfaction, which can impact post-operative quality of vision and also quality of life. Now, if you see certain statistics, immediately after LASIK, almost as high as 95% of patients may report some dry eye symptoms, and as high as 60% of patients may report it even 1 month post-LASIK. Now, if you look at the pre-operative symptoms, they could be as high as a prevalence of 38 to 75%, which we need to pick up so as to avoid complications. Usually it peaks in the first few months after surgery and settles down by 6 to 12 months. Now, if you look at the diagrammatic representation of a normal corneal nerve anatomy of the eye, you can see that this is the subepithelial plexus, the subbasal plexus ending in the sensory nerve terminals in the epithelium. And this is the difference between LASIK and SMILE, which I would be now elaborating in the next few slides. Now, if you look at PRK, for example, we know that there's no flap creation and hence there's lesser damage to the subbasal plexus and lesser to the deeper stromal nerve. So probably it would be better than LASIK. Now, even you look at LASIK, basically what happens is the disruption of both the dense subbasal nerve plexus as well as the stromal nerves in the creation of the flap, which causes denervation of the cornea leading to decreased corneal sensitivity and hence reflex tear secretion is reduced. Now, if you compare a vertical hinge versus the horizontal hinge, probably a horizontal hinge would be better because it would only affect one side of the nerves, whereas in vertical, both the sides would be cut. But studies have shown at the end of 6 months, probably it may not be statistically significant. There are also some people have proposed surgical techniques like smaller flaps with larger hinges, which may reduce risk of postoperative dry eye, or thin planar flaps, which may have lesser dry eye. Now, there are certain studies which have compared SMILE with femtosecond LASIK. And in this case, we have seen that here it says that SMILE may create fewer dry eye symptoms and that corneal sensitivity was greater after SMILE versus femtosecond LASIK. So we all know that because in SMILE, there is a lesser, there is no flap, there is just a small cap cut. Definitely, that is the reason why there is less cutting of nerves and hence less disruption of the normal corneal nerve anatomy. However, there are studies which also show that there is no significant difference in the corneal re-innervation and sensitivity between both of them at 6 months postoperatively. Like in this study, they have shown that SMILE does not show obvious superiority and SMILE patients may just have milder subjective symptoms. And this study shows that SMILE shows superiority over femtosecond LASIK. So basically, it is all the SMILE surgeons would have faced patients both ways. Now, this graph shows that the mean corneal sensation after SMILE came back much earlier, but at the end of 6 months, the statistics was the same. So if you look at the probable pathophysiology of post-refractive surgery dry eye, one reason could be damage to the subbasal nerves, decreased corneal sensitivity, decreased tear secretion, and ocular surface inflammation causing dry eye. Another pathophysiological mechanism could be just a decreased blink rate because of decreased corneal sensitivity, causing decreased meibomian gland secretion, unstable tear film, decreased EBUT. There could also be damage to goblet cells due to suction, leading to altered expression of mucin, leading to instability in the tear film, or just the alteration in the corneal curvature can cause an alteration in the expression of mucin. We all know that dry eye has a very significant proportion of inflammation. It's basically an inflammatory disease. So it could be because of pressure or direct action on the nerve. This could exacerbate a pre-existing dry eye. And basically there are release of inflammatory cytokines in the tear film and the conjunctival epithelium. Now, confocal microscopy has shown, like in this slide here, tortuosity neuroma. So basically a post-refractive dry eye could also be maybe because of pain without stain, which could be triggered by the refractive surgery. So a patient could have disproportionately increased symptoms compared to just signs. Or it could be just that preoperatively a patient had aqueous deficiency or evaporative dry eye, which was missed and that has significantly worsened. So what we as refractive surgeons need to do is a thorough preoperative evaluation right from history, ask for contact lens intolerance, which is a very great indicator that the patient may have dry eye, allergies, medication use, especially anti-glaucoma medications, associated systemic diseases, in the presence of which you would immediately refer it to an immunologist or a rheumatologist. Use patient questionnaires so as to make your job easier, maybe OSDI or DEQ5. Examine the patient like you would do for a proper dry eye patient, with all the tests that you would do for a routine dry eye patient, including the TBUT and the inflammatory biomarkers. We have a lot of gadgets also we can use for non-invasive tests. This is a clinical photograph of a typical line that's a LASIK-induced neurotrophic epitheliopathy staining. These are the confocal microscopy images showing increased bending of nerves, tortuosity, and then the early nerve regeneration post-LASIK. So how is the management different compared to a routine dry eye? So basically, we follow the TFS DEWS2 guidelines, educate the patient regarding environmental modifications, use tear substitutes, preservative-free would be preferred. You can also use the newer thermal-based therapies like the IPL or the LipiFlow. Definitely, LipiFlow cannot be used in the immediate post-operative period. Role of anti-inflammatory agents like cyclosporine, for example, may need to be continued for longer duration, even up to 4 months. This basically helps to prevent activation of T cells and inflammatory cytokines. Topical steroids will act as an anti-inflammatory mode of treatment. It reduces and breaks the inflammatory cascade and host of mechanisms, which will help to reduce the ocular irritation and reduce the amount of dry eye. Definitely, the strength and the duration of steroid would depend on the severity of the problem. Basically, if you have diagnosed a meibomian gland dysfunction in the preoperative period, you need to pre-treat it, improve the MGD by all the procedures like the lid hygiene, warm compresses, or IPL therapy, so as to avoid complications in the post-operative period. You could also use supplementary therapies like omega-3 fatty acids, and as well as the role of vitamin D as an adjuvant therapy. So to conclude, friends, preoperative dry evaluation needs to be done in these patients before you take them up for a refractive surgery. See whether they are an aqueous deficiency, evaporative dry eye, mixed, or a neuropathic dry eye. If it is a severe dry eye, or avoid a refractive surgery totally. If it's just mild or moderate, you would treat them preoperatively and also postoperatively evaluate them. And depending on the severity and the grade of the type of dry eye, you would treat them, whether it's aqueous deficiency, evaporative dry eye, neuropathic pain, and also keep a lookout for toxic dry eye disease. So this was basically the algorithmic approach to evaluation and management of dry eye disease. So basically, a comprehensive understanding of the possible...
I'm just a reminder, you have 30 more seconds to go. Yes, if you could please wrap up.
So we also need to take a detailed history, a customized algorithm like I just described, a systematic approach, timely tests and diagnosis, and appropriate medications and treatment for an adequate duration will ensure good outcomes. Thank you so much for your kind attention. Thank you so much for accommodating me.
Thank you, Anaga. It was a nice talk. Just I wanted to ask you one question that, see, the different modalities of treatment you already explained. In the severe cases with MGD dysfunction, do you do post-LASIK eyelid treatment to the patient also?
Yes, sir, we do. In fact, we do a dry eye workup for all our refractive patients. And if we find that they have MGD, we usually all pre-treat the patient with not only the conventional method, but also with IPL, and then continue the IPL post-op. But because it is non-invasive, unlike the LipiFlow, we can immediately do it within a week's time also.
You are